Okay. Okay, so let's perform the exercise for the three-state POTS model. My friend Angelo Vulpiani, since he will give talks on in a couple of weeks, when we were younger together, we were saying that the POTS model is the model who saves the poor theoretical physicist who cannot compute complicated things. Okay, let's try with the POTS model, which is... Okay, but apart from jokes, it's a very interesting model. I take it in the case of all-to-all interaction. So this is a Kronecker delta over the spins, and the values of the spins are 3. And in the POTS model, I'm free to call the 3 values 1, 2, and 3. I'm not obliged to call them minus 1, 0, and 1. So I can call them 1, 2, and 3. And then there is a Katz scaling, minus j over 2n, so this is the Hamiltonian. Step one, write the Hamiltonian in terms of the global variables. That's very simple. It's minus j over n over 2 times the number of spin a plus square, plus the number of spin b square, plus the number of c square. And there is no rest. So this replies to the question that was in the chat. So in this case, which is an exact mean field model, the rest is 0. In other cases where the rest is non-zero, for instance, we have in one of our papers, we studied the Dyson model. And in that case, the rest is subleading with respect to the main part of the Hamiltonian. It's enough that the rest is subleading with respect to n. And then you can apply the method. In this case, the rest is 0. And what is the random variable? The random variable is a sample mean given the configuration. So given the configuration of the spins, the number of spins A, B, and C fluctuates. Okay. So the random variable is a three-dimensional vector where I count the number of spin A, the number of spin B, and the number of spin C. So in the local random variable, C is the delta on site K. No? On site K, the spin, yes?
Sorry, in the first step, why is N uppercase at the numerator and not at the denominator in the first step?
This one, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, the energy is linear in... this is a fraction of...
All right, it's a fraction.
It's a fraction. Okay. Sorry. This is the fraction of spin A, the fraction of spin B, and the fraction... and this is linear in N. Okay. Otherwise, if I don't use the fraction, there should be... okay. So this N here fixes the N there. Okay. If I divide by N, and that's a fraction. Okay. Sorry, I was not unclear about that. Okay, so then what I do Cramer, and I compute the generating function. The generating function is the average over the spin A, B, C of the exponential of lambda scalar the random variable. The random variable is the Kronecker delta in this case, the Kronecker delta in A, B, and C. And of course, it is one third of exponential lambda A plus exponential lambda B plus exponential lambda C. Then the rate function is the sup of this three-dimensional Legendre-Fenchel transform where I take the log of psi. Now this sup can be explicitly solved. The solution is lambda L equal log NL with L equal ABC, and I get the expression for the rate function. So the rate function is explicitly known for the for the POTS model. So the entropy is minus the rate function plus a correction, which is a number in this case, is log 3, the number of states. Because, okay, it depends. The entropy is the log of the volume, is not the log of the probability, so there is always a constant that can fly away. So what is the microcanonical entropy? The microcanonical entropy is the sup over Na. So the total fraction is 1, okay? So Nc is 1 minus Na minus Nb. So I can write the entropy as a sup over Na and Nb only, and I get a function of the energy, because the energy has this form. So by taking this sup, I get the microcanonical entropy. By taking the inf over Na and B and Nc, I get the canonical free energy. Okay? Now I can do the same as I did with the other models, the Blume-Capelle and the... So I can draw the so-called caloric curve. So this is beta. And this is energy. There is an upper energy. You cannot have energies in this model above minus 1 over 6. And if you are in the canonical free energy case, so if I fix the energy, if I fix beta and I compute the average energy, I am the average energy is minus 1 over 6 until a given inverse temperature. And then there is a jump, there is a first order phase transition, and then there is this is the case for the canonical. So in the canonical ensemble, I have a first order phase transition at the temperature beta T that can be computed explicitly. And this is the Maxwell construction, these two areas are the same. Okay? While in the microcanonical ensemble, I vary the energy, and I compute the microcanonical temperature. And you can see that it decreases the inverse temperature. So I am here in a region of positive specific heat, because I enter a region that would be unstable in the canonical ensemble. So it's metastable in the canonical ensemble. And then I have a region of convex entropy, where the inverse temperature increases. Okay, so the temperature decreases when the energy increases. So all this branch, starting from here, is a negative specific heat branch. So this is a very, very simple... I don't know any simpler model than this one to show ensemble inequivalence. In fact, when I published this paper, there was a series of papers by Richard Ellis, Hugo Touchet, and others, where they formulated this model. Since they had worked a lot with the Curie Weiss, they formulated this model in the language of probability. And for me, it was a big problem because I cannot read such papers. It's very complicated. But they published a lot of papers in Annals of Probability, because this model is extremely simple, so there are several examples of the different theorems of the large deviation theory. And if you want, I can give you the references of these papers. If you are interested in the more type of probability setting for this type of models. There is a question?
There is a question in the chat, I think, which referred to the previous subject before the break. Could you please comment on the convergence of the methods error from a computational point of view?
From me?
Computational point of view. I think it refers to the previous...
The method, I mean the step 1, step 2, step 3. When I approximate the Hamiltonian with the rest can be estimated both analytically and in some cases and computationally in other cases.
Yeah.
So in one of my papers, I can give a reference of one paper where I do an estimate explicitly of the rest. A paper in JSTATFIS where I do explicitly an estimate of the rest. Okay. Yes?
I have a question on the PATS model. In the first place, you compute the rate function by taking the soup between two things. Why? Because before the rate function...
I use Cramer theorem. Cramer theorem tells me how I compute the rate function. So, okay. And the Cramer theorem, you can prove it by Laplace method. It's not difficult to prove.
But can I say
so
again?
So you see, I of x is sup of lambda x minus psi. So it goes in steps. So first you have to compute this average. And this average you compute with the local probability distribution function. Okay?
Yes.
Then... So it's like the spins were independent.
Yeah.
Okay. Then you have the rate function, okay, which is and then you have a large you have a large deviation principle if with a function I which you get from this from the soup.
Okay, and if I can see the expression of the rate function that we obtain in the PATS model.
Yes. I hope there is a mistake.
I just want to check something.
Yes. This is the rate function.
Yes.
Log of psi, and then you have to Lejeune transform.
Okay.
In this case, it's simple because you just derive, log of psi, and okay. So let us now turn to a more complicated model, and we try to use the same tricks. Now I will discuss three type of different models. One is the, so I include in this model just to show that it's possible to obtain results. Also the kinetic energy. Also the kinetic energy can be thought as a global variable. It's an average, okay? It's a sum, okay? So this is order n, this is order n. I am summing vectors. And this, and then I take a square of the square, okay? An additional term. Is without the additional term, this Hamiltonian will be like the Curie-Weiss Hamiltonian, and there is not any interesting. If you add this term k, then you get a phase transition, and you can get non-trivial behaviors. So let's. I took this slide. So what are the global variables in this case? The global variables are the x component of the spin, the y component of the spin, and the kinetic energy. Okay, these are the global variables. So, and then I can express the energy as a function of all the three global variables. This is the kinetic energy, this is the m squared, and this is m4, okay? So then what is the local variable? The local random variables is the Heisenberg vector, cosine of theta, sine of theta, and p square is a local random variable. And then I can get the expression for psi. And these I leave to you. It's not difficult. essentially you have exponential of lambda x cosine, so it's a Bessel function, a reduced Bessel function of zero order. There is a problem with the kinetic energy. I leave to you to comment on that. But okay, it's not a problem. Psi of lambda is so I have to do an approximation, but the term here are subleading, and when you take the log, it's okay. So the inverse of the entropy has this expression. See the usual form of the Legendre-Fenchel transform, and then as a step three, I have to take the sup over this function over S, which is minus I, okay, at fixed energy. So I have to solve this variational problem. And if I solve this variational problem, I can show you the result. So this is the phase diagram. This phase diagram, so this is K over J, and this is T over J. At K equals zero, there is a second order phase transition at temperature 0.5. And then there is a line of second order phase transition, and if I would have solved besides the canonical problem, also the canonical problem, then I would have found a line of first order phase transition here. But in the canonical ensemble, the line of second order phase transition continues, is a straight line in this case, it's very simple. And then there is a microcanonical tricritical point, and there is a split with the two temperatures, the upper temperature and the lower temperatures, and then it continues. So you see that now the region of inequivalence that was very compressed in the Blume-Capelle model, here the difference is order 1 between the two points, it's not order 10 to the minus 3. So we can easily reach regions where the two ensembles give inequivalent results. For instance, here you can see that the microcanonical and the canonical agree in saying that this is a magnetized phase. But here, for instance, the microcanonical will tell you that it is a paramagnetic phase, while the canonical will tell you that it is a ferromagnetic phase. So they disagree. They disagree in the order, in the value of the order parameter in these two regions. While here they agree on the fact that they are both in the paramagnetic phase. This is a numerical simulation performed with molecular dynamics. Now that I have kinetic energy, instead of using the Monte Carlo by Kreutz, I can directly integrate the equations of motion of the model, and I can average the quantities. Temperature will be kinetic energy, and you see that the agreement between the simulations, these are the points, and the theory, the continuous line, is quite good. The system with 100 particles, 100 spins. You see the negative specific heat. So this is a molecular dynamic simulation, so I'm integrating over orbits, and I find a negative specific heat. So if I were able to see this system in real physics, it would have a negative specific heat. So here I'm increasing the temperature, the energy, and the temperature goes down. This is exactly, not exactly, but very similar to the model that brought me to study this field. So I was performing numerical simulations, and I found this in molecular dynamics, and I was finding this very curious negative specific heat region. And there is a temperature jump here. So for instance, if I would place here this energy, and I run the molecular simulation, the molecular dynamic simulation, I would see a bimodal distribution of temperatures. So the higher temperature and the lower temperature will be both represented at this energy, and I would observe a sort of bimodal distribution of the temperature. Okay, this is one example. Then, okay, I wanted to show you some problems on which I have been working, so applications, okay? One after the other. So this is a paper I published. I was trying to publish it in PRL. I think it was nice to have a PRL on such a problem because it was very interdisciplinary, but it was rejected, and then it appeared as PRE, rapid communication. So I asked a friend what is a free electron laser. So, and then he showed me equations that are very, very long. So I decided that I could not find anything for such Hamiltonian. So I decided to reduce the complexity of this model. And I found this model by Bonifacio, who is an Italian physicist from Milano, and which is a model of so the free electron laser is also here in Trieste. There is a new one. When we were working on this problem, one of the co-authors is Giovanni De Nino, who is working on the free electron laser here. And they were still planning the length of this region, the region of the magnets. And I thought that my calculation could have been useful to tell the engineers how long should be this magnetic region. So we even tried to go to the experimental site when we wrote this paper to talk to the engineers, but they were interested in totally different problems. So it was clear that they were not following our advices for the planning of the machine. So we went on our own. So what is a free electron laser, first of all? Because let's talk a little bit about physics, okay? So there is a gun of electrons, and the electrons go through an electron accelerator, an electric field, and they get out when they are accelerated from this field. And then there is a region of opposite swapping magnets. So the electron is like this, and the magnet is like this. So if it is south-north, it turns like this. If it is north-south, it goes like this, okay? So it's called the wiggler, so because the trajectory of the electron wiggles when you pass through this region. And since the electron is accelerated, it emits radiation. So in this region, the electron and the field are interacting each other, and this model captures this interaction. So this is the self-generated field. This is the vector potential of the self-generated field. And theta is the position of the electron inside the wave of the self-generated field. And these are indeed, one starts from relativistic invariant equations and then write the equations in the center of mass, and in the end it's an Hamiltonian form. This is interesting. So these equations of motion, although they are free, so it's very curious, because you think Hamiltonian system should have an even number of equations. The reason why they are three is that the field is a dual. So there is an equation also for A star, which is dual to A. So A star is the conjugate variable to A. In fact, in the Hamiltonian, you have a term A star, okay, which is the gives this. So this is a Hamiltonian. I don't remember if I've written the Hamiltonian. And I can use the same trick. Because it's you see that this is called the bunching of electrons. This is a parameter that is measured experimentally, the bunching of electrons. And this is called the tuning. And this is the amplitude of the field, and this is the relative kinetic energy in a frame that moves with the electron. So you see it's a very different problem, but it can be treated exactly in the same way. So this is the Hamiltonian. A is the square root of A square. And this is the entropy, computed exactly, where the configurational entropy is very similar to the entropy of the XY model. And then you have to solve this soup for the configurational entropy, and you get a second order phase transition in the microcanonical ensemble. The system is isolated, so the canonical ensemble is very inappropriate for this system because the system is isolated. Energy is really conserved. The electrons travel in the empty region, so it's isolated. In fact, this type of transition is very interesting because it's present also in cold atoms, in cavities. So we have a series of papers also on that. But it's interesting physically that you can compute a second order phase transition in an object of this kind. But okay, this is something that I will discuss tomorrow, but this is why our paper was rejected. I try to explain to you why our paper was rejected. So this is a simulation of the Hamiltonian. This is the intensity of the laser. The laser has a certain intensity, and the intensity grows. Then there are oscillation dumps around this value, okay? Now, and then, if you wait long enough, you see the damping at this level. If you wait long enough, there are other trajectories here. There is a slow drift, and finally you reach this other level. There is a gap between the... What our theory was predicting was this level here, not this level here. Okay? So we were arguing a different theory, which was inspired to the theory that I will present tomorrow. Why I stay around this level for such a long time, okay? It has to do with another entropy, the Lindenbell entropy, and I will introduce the Lindenbell entropy tomorrow, if I will have time. And then you see that there is a drift to a new value. So that there is a very fast relaxation to a level, and then there is a drift to a different level. I can predict with statistical mechanics the higher level, not the lower level. And the point is that one of the referees was a person in free electron lasers, and he computed how long would be the free electron laser in order to reach the higher level. And the length was 1 parsec. So clearly, you cannot construct on Earth a free electron laser of a length of 1 parsec. So totally unrealistic length. So the time of convergence to statistical mechanics, or the length of convergence to statistical mechanics, makes it totally unphysical in this problem. While the laser seems to relax to a laser intensity. So what is this laser intensity that to which the system relaxes? And will be the subject of the next lecture. We have constructed a statistical theory for such a level of relaxation. It introduces another problem in long-range interactions, which is the presence of the what we have called the quasi-stationary states, so states in which the relaxation is fast, the phase space is occupied but only in parts, the system is not ergodic, and it's visiting only one part of the phase space, and only by diffusing slower and slower it can reach the ergodicity and then give the value of the statistical mechanics, the maximum entropy value. So this is a story that it's a long story. It has to do with the Lindenbell distributions and with the fact that there is a phenomenon that's called violent relaxation, And I will try to describe this phenomenon in the next talk, where I will speak about dynamics, not about statistical mechanics. So, and just to finish, this is also another model. For theoretical physics, it's an important model. It's phi-4 model. So I have a local potential with a Hamiltonian with a local potential which is a double well, okay, locally. So the variable is continuous, but locally I have a double well. So it means that the particle will spend most of its time either in one well or in the other. So like an Ising spin, okay? So it will be around the minimum of a well and at some point around another minimum. Now, if you couple with the Q-revised term, this continuous variable, you will have a phase transition of the type of the Ising phase transition in the mean field of the type of the Q-revised phase transition, but with continuous variables. The model was introduced by Desai and Zwanzig. And they studied the model in presence of noise, and they looked at the stationary solution of the Fokker-Planck equation. It was totally different analysis. But we re-derived the results using our method, which implies computing entropies. So also here you have global variables, the kinetic energy, the local potential, and the mean field. You can compute log of psi using the Cramer problem, and then by taking the soup, you can get the entropy as a function of the energy and of the local magnetization. Now I have access to another quantity, which is the entropy as a function of energy and of the local magnetization. So I would like to check another property for long range system, which is: are there other response functions that are the wrong signature in a long-range system? So this is the entropy as a function of M, and as you can clearly see, there is a phase transition, and there is only a maximum in zero. At some point, the maximum in zero becomes a minimum, and there are two side minima. And this, so you see that this model in the microcanonical has a phase transition exactly as but I can define the field in a different way, because you know in the canonical ensemble I can define the magnetization by deriving the free energy with respect to the field. In the microcanonical ensemble, the definition goes opposite. So the field is not present in the Hamiltonian. H is not present, but if you derive this is a thermodynamic formula, TdS equal D minus HdM. If you derive the entropy with respect to M, and then you multiply by the temperature, like here, you get the field as a function of M. The opposite. You don't get the M as a function of the field, but you get the field as a function of M. And now of course, in the canonical ensemble would be totally different. I can compute the susceptibility. Susceptibility is the MDH. But in the microcanonical will be the inverse of DHDM, and you get this function. And since in the canonical ensemble, the curvature is always positive, but in the microcanonical ensemble, it can happen that this quantity is negative. And so the susceptibility can be negative. And this is the simulation. And you can see that the field, if I increase M, the field increases. But then there is a region where if I increase M, the field decreases. And you can see chi, the susceptibility here, that becomes negative. And this is a numerical simulation, again, molecular dynamic simulation, to check that the susceptibility is negative. So this specific heat is only one among the several response functions that you can introduce in the context of thermodynamics, which can become negative due to non-additivity. Of course, if I change the story and they make the model additive, the, all these features will disappear. So this was very fast. I recognize I had no time enough. You can read the slides. I put the slides on the on, and you please check. There might be errors. So this lecture showed that large deviations are a powerful tool to derive microcanonical entropies. They have several applications, but this is one. And the first simple example was the POTS model. And then we have looked at the generalized XY models, Goldson-Bonifacio model for the electron free electron laser, and Phi-4 theory. And this is the lecture today, finishes now. Okay.
Any question? So we don't have a question on Zoom. So this was not just stretching. Okay. So thank you very much, Stefano. I think we can close here. We'll meet again at 4 p.m.
Io sono a Trieste in questo momento.
For quindi the next lecture of David Wolpert.
Casa di cura? Sì, era dimenticato.